This video tutorial is an introduction to some of the new features in OWASP ZAP version 2.4.0. My name is Simon Bennett and I'm the ZAP project lead. There are lots of new features, so I'm just going to cover the main ones at a high level. The plan is for future videos to focus on individual features in more depth. I'm going to assume that you're already familiar with ZAP. If not, it's worth having a look at the ZAP homepage and maybe some of the training videos we've already recorded. First thing you'll see when you start ZAP is a new splash screen, which includes a progress bar and ZAP hints and tips. You should find this version starts significantly faster than previous versions. The next thing you'll see is a dialog asking if you'd like to persist the ZAP session. We added this because we found that many people only saved their ZAP session when they'd finished testing. This is not the best approach, as it will take longer to save big sessions, and if ZAP or your machine crashes before you save the session, then you could lose your work. The session is persisted in the database, so you only need to do it once at the start. Everything you do from that point on is stored in the database, so you don't need to persist it again. You'll see there are a lot fewer tabs than before. Don't worry, we haven't removed any functionality, but we found that showing all of the available tabs at startup was intimidating to new users, and there are some tabs that even experienced users only used occasionally. Instead, we start off by just showing the essential tabs, and the rest either appear when they're used or when you choose to show them. There are a couple of buttons on the main toolbar for managing tabs. One will show all of the available tabs. The other will hide unpinned tabs. Hidden tabs are available via the special tabs with green pluses. You can pin any tab you like by using the small pin icon on that tab. It will then always be shown when you restart ZAP. Tabs will also appear when irrelevant, so if I start a quick scan, you'll see that the spider tab first appears, and then the active scan one is shown. You will also see that contexts are now shown in the sites tree, along with a new toolbar that allows you to easily create, import, and export contexts. Contexts are becoming increasingly important in ZAP. They're the way you can assign different characteristics to the applications you're testing. If you don't use contexts, then you'll be missing out on a lot of really powerful features that ZAP provides. We've simplified the way that ZAP intercepts messages. By default, there is now only one break button, which causes ZAP to intercept all requests and responses. And when ZAP does intercept a request, then by default it will force ZAP to the front. You can change this behaviour via the pop-up that's shown first time this happens, or via the options. Clicking on the Submit and Continue button will unset the global break option, but not custom breakpoints that you can define to intercept messages based on a variety of criteria. The way you invoke attacks has also changed. When you right-click a node in the sites tree, or a request in one of the tables, you'll see a lot fewer options. This is because most of the menu items now open dialogs which allow you to easily select the most commonly used options. They also have advanced options that give you fine-grained control over all aspects. This is currently supported by the standard spider, the Ajax spider, and the active scanner. We also have a completely new fuzzing dialog, which can be invoked via the right-click attack menu, or by highlighting a request string and right-clicking it. This dialog now allows you to fuzz multiple positions at any one time, and has many more options for generating different attack vectors and pre and post processing the requests and responses. Payload processors allow you to process a payload prior to it being used, so attack vectors could be encoded as file uploads or padded out to an expected length. ZAP also has a new mode. The attack mode will actively scan all the URLs you explore via ZAP that are in scope. When you select the attack mode, you'll be asked if you want to rescan the nodes when the scope changes. You'll typically want to do this if you haven't got any URLs in scope yet, or if you have already started exploring an application and want to scan the URLs that you have visited. You might not want to do this if the application is particularly large and you just want to attack the parts you've not explored yet. To add URLs to the scope, you need to add them to a context, either the default one or a new one. By default, all contexts are in scope, but you can change that via right-click options. So what I'll do is create a new session. Visit budget, and then add that to the default context. You'll see that the budget icons now have the target icon on them. And you can change the scope of the context via right-click options. So ZAP will now actively scan all of the URLs I visit. And you'll see it's already found a cross-site scripting vulnerability in one of the pages. The last change I'm going to show you in this tutorial is scan policies. The Scan Policy Manager allows you to create and edit as many different scan policies as you need, and a default policy and a separate policy just for the attack mode. Scan policies define exactly how the active scanner works, including the rules to run, the threshold at which potential vulnerability is reported, and the strength of the attacks, which directly corresponds to the number of attacks performed. You can change these properties across all rules, across categories of rules, or to individual rules. There are lots of other changes in this release, including two important new alpha add-ons that provide support for access control testing and sequence scanning. These can be downloaded from the ZAP marketplace. you do have any questions or problems with ZAP, then there are links to the ZAP wiki, user group, developer group, and issue tracker from the online menu. We hope you enjoy this release.